So we'll continue our discussion from the point where we finished in last class. So that is limited source diffusion. Limited source diffusion, it corresponds to drive-in diffusion, whereas P diffusion is a constant surface concentration diffusion. Now this class of diffusion, the total dopant will remain constant. Whatever the dopant incorporated during the pre-diffusion time, that same dopant will redistribute in this particular limited source diffusion. And the profile shape will also change. Now here the boundary condition will be that at the beginning, means initial condition at t equal to 0, there will be certain amount of dopant, and that dopant will be fixed throughout the diffusion. And only those amount of dopant atoms will redistribute throughout the bulk of the semiconductor. That means at x, at t equal to 0, n x 0 equal to q naught delta x, and this q naught is the total dopant, and it is basically the integral n x t dx over the entire length. And you can see here the n x t, all this concentration, I hope you have noticed that this is a one-dimensional, because the profile in one line it is given, x. It's not 2D. If it is a 2D, that means a lateral direction, what should be the diffusion, that is not shown in this particular case. It's only 1D. And the fixed diffusion equation, which you solved, that is also the 1D, isn't it? So that's why it will give the profile along x, vertical. But along y direction, means lateral direction, you don't know what should be the profile. Okay. And boundary conditions of these limited source diffusions are known as Cauchy's condition. And that is, since at the surface, means x equal to 0 at any time, that dopant is constant. So if you take derivative del n del x, that will be 0, since that is constant. And the second one is at infinite time, that means if the drive-in diffusion continues for a long time, under that condition, it may so happen that n x infinity, that means at any distance of x, it will be 0. Why? The reason is that, so if you diffuse for quite a long time, then the dopant atoms will evaporate. That is, from the silicon, since from the source, the dopant atoms are going inside, at the same time, from the surface, dopant atoms are also going outside. Because once is diffusion inside the crystal, other is out diffusion from the surface to the environment, inside the bulk, inside the chamber. Okay, that is known as evaporation. So that means without any constant source at the surface, if we continue diffusion for a longer time, infinite time, so to say, then there is a chance that after infinite time, all the dopant atoms will evaporate. Okay, so that is the condition here in the second one, n x infinity equal to 0. So using this initial condition and boundary conditions, these three boundary conditions, if we put into Fick's second law, then its solution is like that: n x t is equal to q naught divided by square root pi dt exponential minus x by 2 root dt square. And this particular profile, if you plot, it will be similar to the Gaussian profile. The distribution is Gaussian distribution, and the profile is similar to the Gaussian. I will show in the next view graph how the profile looks like. And here, the q naught is given by 2 n naught d1 t1 by pi under root. What is a d1 t1? d1 t1 is basically the pre-deposition time, and d1 is the diffusion constant at pre-deposition temperature. Okay, that's why it is d1 t1 is written. So that means whatever the dopant atom incorporated into the surface, that will be given by q naught is equal to, and that is obtained integral of n x t dx. And that value, if you integrate it over limit, certain limit from 0 to certain depth x, then it will be q naught equal to 2 n naught d1 t1 by pi under root. Okay. Now, if you see the doping profile, then it looks like this. You see here. Here, for different dt values, that means for different time, if you keep d constant, then for different time, that you see in this direction the curve, the time in dt increases. Dt increases means at constant temperature, then we can assume that time increases. If we keep the temperature fixed, then if time increases, then dt will increases in this direction, and the dt product dimension is micron length. It is also known as a diffusion length. Dt product is sometimes called diffusion length, and its dimension is micron. Okay. Now here you see the dt is 0.1 micron. Here it is 0.5 micron. Here it is 1 micron. That means if we diffuse for a longer time, then we found that the surface concentration, that means x equal to 0, the value of in xt reduces. So for a small time it is here, and then if I increase the time from this point, it is reduced here, and again if we diffuse it further longer time, when dt under root dt is a 1 micron, then we found it has reduced too much. And at the same time, you can see here that the profile shape has changed. Earlier it was like this, and 0.5 micron the profile changes like that, and 1 micron profile is much more broadened. So here one thing you can visualize, that total area inside this curve should be constant, because total area will be the total dopant, isn't it? I mean, if you integrate the nxt over length x equal to 0 to say x equal to 3 micron, then the value will be same as if you integrate the surface is here, integrate from x equal to 0 to x equal to 1.5, something like that. So then it will remain same. The q naught equal to constant total dopant. Okay. And it is log n xt versus x in micron, that is plotted here. Again here another blue line curve you can see, which is the surface concentration, that means background concentration. So that means if you dope boron in n type substrate, then this particular point will give you the junction, and that will be the junction depth. That means if you are told to find the junction depth after pre-deposition and drive-in diffusion, then you have to, in the same profile, you have to plot the background concentration, and that background concentration means that you see, we assume here it is independent of the distance, it is a constant concentration, because the substrate we assume here, which is diffused, that has got uniform concentration of dopant concentration. Okay. So that's why this curve is just a parallel line to the x-axis, and the value of the substrate concentration is somewhere here. Okay. So this will be the profile of limited source diffusion, and here both limited source and constant source diffusion, if you look, then following conclusions can be drawn. One is both error function, that is complementary error function diffusion, and Gaussian profile, both depend on 2 root dt, the root dt, and that is equal to 2 into diffusion length. The under root dt is sometimes called diffusion length. Q naught equal to total integrated dose, which is number of impurity atoms per unit area, that is Q naught. Ion implanted profiles are full Gaussian and are similar to drive-in profiles, which is half Gaussian. This is half Gaussian. What is the Gaussian profile? Gaussian profile means the same thing will repeat in this side also, that is full Gaussian. And we will discuss in the next chapter ion implantation. There we will found that ion implantation profiles are full Gaussian profile. But here in drive-in diffusion, that is limited source diffusion, is half Gaussian profile. One half of the Gaussian profile you are getting, but in implantation you will get the full half, both this half like this and this, both you will get. Okay. So now, normally in practical situation, we go for two-step diffusion. What are the two steps? That those two steps are pre-deposition followed by driving. So pre-deposition is a constant concentration diffusion, and driving is the limited source diffusion. That means constant surface concentration diffusion, another is limited source diffusion. And finally, impurity distribution in a two-step diffusion can be given by this equation, and that is nx t1 t2 is equal to 2n01 by pi integral 0 to u e to the power minus beta 1 plus u square, that is u square, not u2, u square, divided by 1 plus u square du. So that is the final impurity distribution profile, where u is given by under root d1 t1 by d2 t2, and this beta, which is the exponential factor beta, that is x by 2 under root d1 t1 d2 t2 square, where t1 is the pre-deposition time and t2 is the driving time. That means t1 corresponds to constant concentration diffusion time and t2 corresponds to limited source diffusion time. D1 is the diffusion constant at temperature. What temperature? That is pre-deposition temperature. And D2 is the diffusion constant value at driving temperature. Okay. So final surface concentration is given by N02 equal to 2N01 by pi tan inverse U. Okay. Now there are certain situation, practical situation you may face, where the successive diffusion are done. In many of practical cases, successive diffusions are done. For example, you see, when you are making emitter in case of bipolar transistor, then what happens? The base region, one pre-deposition, then you are coming drive-in, then when you are going for emitter pre-deposition, that time another drive-in of base will occur. When you go for emitter drive-in, that time base is earlier done, so another drive-in of base will occur. So that's why in the base region is facing one pre-deposition and three drive-in. One is base drive-in, another is along with emitter pre-deposition, one drive-in, and then along with the emitter drive-in, another drive-in of the base. Because you cannot isolate the emitter region for drive-in and pre-deposition without the base. Base region you are protecting means pre-deposition will not be done along with emitter. No pre-deposition along with emitter, but that temperature cycle base will face, and because of that the base drive-in will take place. Although base region is covered by oxide, no impurity will go into. Whatever impurity was there earlier in base pre-deposition, those impurity will reduce to it. You cannot prevent it, isn't it? So that's why those are known as successive diffusion. That means that region is experienced three temperature cycle, one during pre-deposition, one during drive-in, another during emitter pre-deposition, another during emitter drive-in. Similarly, you see buried layer. Buried layer will face lot of temperature cycles because that was the first stage you are doing, and that buried layer, all these steps, subsequent steps, high temperature, either pre-deposition or diffusion steps, the buried layer impurity will redistribute inside the silicon bulb. Because of that redistribution, each stage the profile shape will change, isn't it? So in those conditions, if you are told to find the profile, and you can do so by using two-step diffusion relation, you use it, but the dt product you change it by dt effective, and that dt effective will be summation of d1 t1 plus d2 t2 plus dt t3 plus d4 t4 etc. Isn't it? Now the same equation you can use, only you can replace dt by dt effective, and dt effective is given by this relation. That is successive diffusion. Okay. So these two step diffusion and successive diffusions are some practical examples of the earlier stages diffusion. For example, buried layer, as I told you, and base also will experience different temperature cycles. Now impurity behavior in silicon, we'll see how different impurity behaves in silicon. Impurities belonging to group 3 and 5 are substitutional diffusers in silicon, that I also mentioned during discussion diffusion mechanism. Examples of this class of diffusion is aluminium, boron, gallium, indium, those are p-type, and arsenic, antimony, phosphorus, those are n-type. So that means group 3 are aluminium, boron, gallium, indium. These four elements are used as a dopant in from group 3, and these are all group 3 elements, so they will be p-type dopant in silicon, isn't it? Silicon is a group 4 element, valency 4, so one less, that means group 3 elements will be the p-type dopant for silicon. Similarly, group 5 elements are arsenic, antimony, phosphorus, those are n-type, this group 5 element. These three are popular elements which are frequently used as a n-type dopant in silicon. Their motion is influenced by the number and the charge state of the lattice defects. These lattice defects are what? Those are vacancies. If vacancies are there, then again the charge state. So that means how the impurity will diffuse, how it will redistribute, that depends on how many vacancies are there. That I told you at the beginning, the substitutional diffusion, isn't it? So there, that means if there is absolutely no lattice defect, no vacancy, then problem, that means what problem? The dopant atom cannot occupy a vacancy state and diffusion will not occur. And next, impurities belonging to groups 1 and 8 move interstitially in silicon. That will lead to interstitial diffusion. These include alkali metals such as lithium, sodium, potassium, and argon, helium, hydrogen, etc. They are all electronically active. Normally, group 1 and group 8, these impurity diffusions, we are not interested in VLSI technology or in silicon because they are never used. Next point is most transition elements like cobalt, copper, gold, iron, nickel, silver, etc. They diffuse by an interstitial substitutional mechanism. Interstitial substitutional mechanism is a combination of interstitial and substitutional or vacancy mechanism. So they diffuse by interstitial substitutional mechanism, that is interchange. Interstitial site to vacancy site interchange, that is the interstitial substitutional mechanism. So these impurities reduce the minority carrier lifetime in silicon. So they are used intentionally in high speed saturated logic circuit. These particularly atoms, gold diffusion, sometimes intentionally we do gold diffusion in case of some logic circuits where we want to kill the minority carrier lifetime so that the speed of the circuit will be improved. For example, in high speed TTL gates, sometimes we use dopant like gold, etc., intentionally to kill the lifetime. Okay, so that will be necessary in case of high speed saturated logic circuits. So now these are the behaviors of different impurity atoms in silicon. Next, we'll discuss on dopants. For silicon, p-type dopants are aluminium, boron, gallium, indium. These are all from group 3, as I mentioned in earlier slide also. N-type dopants are arsenic, antimony, phosphorus. Those belong to group 5 metal. Now, for gallium arsenide, again, we will see what dopants are used. Their p-type dopants are beryllium, cadmium, magnesium, mercury, and zinc. And group 2 elements move along the gallium sublattice. N-type dopants in gallium arsenide are selenium, sulfur, tellurium. Now here, another interesting point is that there are some class of dopant elements which may change the semiconductor conductivity from n type, either n type or p type. And that depends on a certain nomenclature. What are those nomenclatures? That is, when they group four elements, that means carbon, germanium, silicon, and tin, SN, so they can be either n type or p type depending on the sublattice on which they are preferentially located. They move on both sublattices. Now let us little bit explain these gallium arsenide dopants. Those are true in case of other 3-5 semiconductors. Silicon is elemental semiconductor. It belongs to group 4 element. Similarly, gallium arsenide is a compound semiconductor, gallium and arsenic. Gallium belongs to group 3 element and arsenic belongs to group 5 element. Now, if I want to make gallium arsenide, say p type, then we have to dope elements one group lower than the host semiconductor material. That is, here we have to choose the group 2 element. And group 2 element is beryllium, cadmium, magnesium, mercury and zinc. Those elements are popular group 2 elements which are used in case of gallium arsenide. So in that case there is no problem, because all these elements belong to group 2 and they move along the gallium sublattices. Because gallium is group 3, one below, that is group 2, that is beryllium, cadmium, magnesium, mercury, zinc all. Now, if I want to change gallium arsenide to n-type, then obviously we have to choose elements which is one group higher than the host semiconductor material. So here, host semiconductor is gallium group 2 and arsenic group 5. Then if it is a group 5, then we have to choose group 6 material. And group 6 materials are Se, S and Te, sulfur. Sulfur is and tellurium, these are highly selenium, Se. So these are popular group 6 elements which are used as an n-type dopants in gallium arsenide. Okay? But when the selenium, sulfur and telluriums are used, they always move along the arsenic sublattice. They don't move along the gallium sublattice. Now, another interesting point is that in case of gallium arsenide, you can use silicon and germanium as a dopant. Silicon is a group 4 material. So now you see, since silicon is a group 4 material, it is one group higher than the group 3, one higher group than group 3, that is the gallium. Gallium is group 3, this is group 4. So it is one group higher. So that means it may act as one group higher, means it may act as an n-type dopant. On the other hand, you see the silicon, germanium, carbon and tin, they group 4 means it is one group lower than arsenic. Arsenic is group 5. So that one group lower will give you what? P-type dopant, isn't it? That means if we think with respect to gallium, then this same dopant atoms will lead to the n-type dopant. On the other hand, if we look all these elements with respect to arsenic, then they may contribute p-type dopant. And actually it happens. And when, that means there, when it will act as an n-type, then obviously these dopant atoms must move along the sublattice of gallium. Then it will be working as an n-type dopant. But when we want to use the same dopants for p-type, so they must move along the sublattice of arsenic. Now, who will determine whether those elements will move along the gallium sublattice or along the arsenic sublattice? And that is determined by diffusion temperatures. Same element, there is a certain temperature. If you do the diffusion below certain temperature, they will move along the gallium sublattice. And if you increase the temperature, the diffusion is done at a higher temperature, they may move along the arsenic sublattice. So by controlling that one, you may use the same element as a p-type dopant and as an n-type dopant. The similar thing happens in case of other 3-5 semiconductor material, indium phosphide, for example. Okay, so this is the case with the 3-5 semiconductors. Now, The choice of dopants. We will discuss now. The different dopants are available, and those are painting a slurry on dopant source, spin on source, gaseous source, solid source, liquid source, and their few features are also mentioned along with the name of the dopant. For example, painting a slurry of dopant source and the inert oxide in polyvinyl alcohol are used sometimes on semiconductor surface, and these inert oxides are barium oxide, calcium oxide, magnesium oxide, silicon dioxide, etc. And those are inert oxide. Along with that, the dopant source is mixed using polyvinyl alcohol. Polyvinyl alcohol and those inert oxide which contain those impurity atoms, they are mixed together, and they are painted on the surface of silicon and or any conducting surface. Then at high temperature it is diffused and diffusion will take place. That is one. That is old technique, and nowadays people don't use that one. Next is spin-on source. Spin-on source is similar to photolithography, what you have done. So similarly, the viscous liquid in the liquid dopants are used for spinning the wafer. Just like photoresist, you are spinning on wafer using a spinner machine. Similarly, the liquid dopant are dispensed on the silicon surface, and by spinning you can get uniform thickness of this source, and that is baked at a particular temperature, for example 200 degrees centigrade, and so that, and spin speed is adjusted such that you can get nearly 4000 to 5000 angstrom unit of this spin on source thickness, and then after drying you insert the wafers in furnace at a high temperature. Then from that source the dopants will be introduced into the silicon or any semiconductor material. So that is spin on source. Next one is gaseous source. Gaseous source are very common and simple. The sources are in the form of gas. For example, for boron you can use diborane gas, for arsenic you can use arsine gas, for phosphorus you can use phosphine gas. Those are hydrides of the dopant gases. Those dopant gases with certain concentration, those are diluted. Raw arsine, raw silane or raw phosphine is never used. They are diluted with some carrier gases, and they are introduced into the diffusion furnace chamber so that diffusion will take place at high temperature. So those gaseous sources are popular in many diffusion techniques. Next comes solid source. Here source of dopant oxide is kept in a platinum boat inside the chamber, and a carrier gas transports vapor from this source and deposit them on semiconductor slice. That is one technique. Another technique is solid source can be directly placed on the semiconductor slice by CVD technique. That means doped oxide deposition. By CVD technique you deposit and then you can diffuse. Another technique which you use in our laboratory is boron nitride cake. That is also solid source. And how we made it, that is using boric oxide B2O3 and some binders material, by using a hot press technique there are made slices, and those slices are treated initially activate, and those are placed just close to the silicon surface. Just one by one you can put on the carriers, and then at high temperature it will diffuse. From the boron nitride cake the dopant atoms will introduce into silicon surface. That is also solid source diffusion. Similarly for phosphorus also you can get the solid source, that is PDS 1000 or PDS 2000. Those are the trade names of phosphorus diffusion sources, solid diffusion sources. Similarly, some boron diffusion source solid you can see in our laboratory. that is BN975, BN1100, those are boron nitride solid sources. And the last one is the liquid source. Now, liquid source requires some bubbler arrangements. Liquids are basically dopant compounds available in liquid form, that is the chloride, basically chloride or bromide. Halogen compounds are liquid. Boron tribromide, BBr3, phosphorus oxychloride, POCl3, so arsenic chloride, those are the liquid sources. The liquid sources, if you want to use for diffusion, then obviously you have to use certain bubbler arrangement. What is that? I will show in a diagram how the bubbler arrangement is. So these are the choice of dopants in different forms. Now I will discuss on diffusion systems. Sealed tube diffusion, open tube diffusion, those are two main category of diffusion systems. Sealed tube diffusions are free from contamination, can attain solid solubility at diffusion temperature easily. Pressure 1 torr is used. That is a sealed tube diffusion. What is that technique? Sealed means both side is closed. That means you have to insert the silicon wafers and then you keep the diffusion dopant source, and dopant source and the wafers are kept in a quartz capsule. It is known as capsule, quartz capsule. Then both the ends you close it by sealing. Okay. Now the whole module is inserted into the diffusion furnace, and then diffusion will take place. After diffusion is completed, what you have to do? You have to take out the wafers, slices. How can you take it out? You have to break the capsule. That means one diffusion means one capsule you have to break. This is a destructive thing. That is a sealed tube diffusion. Because after keeping the dopant source and the slices, you have to seal both the open ends. And inside that, a vacuum of 1 torr is used, a pressure of 1 torr is used inside. That is used particularly in case of C5 semiconductor. The reason is that if you do open tube diffusion, then what will happen? In C5 semiconductor, the slices are made up to group 3 and group 5 elements, gallium and arsenic. Now there, the saturation vapor pressure of both the of the elements in a 3-5 semiconductors are not same. For example, gallium and arsenic, saturation vapor pressure are not same. Then what will happen during diffusion? Some of the arsenic atom will evaporate, and then the stoichiometric ratio of gallium and arsenic will be disturbed. It will not maintain. One arsenic, one gallium will give you one gallium arsenide. Now you see, if the during the diffusion process, if many of the arsenic atom evaporates, then the slice will be gallium rich slice. The wafer will be gallium rich, because gallium and arsenic 1:1, the stoichiometric ratio is disturbed, is lost. To prevent that, what we can do, we can seal the tube so that arsenic cannot come out of the tube and it is exhausted in the atmosphere. So whatever arsenic is lost from the surface, that arsenic has to again incorporate into the particular device. If it is a seal, that means those arsenic cannot come out, it will be there. After some time it will be saturated, then ultimately the total loss of arsenic will not be there. So for that reason, sometimes in 3-5 semiconductor, either gallium arsenide or indium phosphide, we go for sealed tube diffusion. But it is a problematic. Problematic means what? You have to break. When you take out the slices, you have to break the capsule. And whatever the dopant source you are using, you may not reuse it. And those dopant sources are kept in a small platinum container inside the tube. If you use the phosphorus pentoxide, this is in a powder form, in a platinum crucible, keep inside the capsule along with the slices, then you seal it. Okay. But the advantages are that free from contamination, since it is a seal on both sides, from atmosphere, some carrier gas, contamination cannot reach inside the tube. That is one advantage. And it can attain solute solubility limit at diffusion temperature easily, because both sides are sealed and inside the tube will be saturated with the dopant atom, so it will reach the solute solubility limit at that particular temperature. Now, next, coming to the open tube diffusion, that is most common diffusion techniques which are used in laboratories and in industrial environments also. Okay. So here both sides are open, and the open tube diffusion, one diagram I will show you here, you can see. In this drawing here, you see one tube is there, that is the quartz tube, that is known as the diffusion tube. And here the red symbols are heating elements are there. So some heaters are there and some fire bricks are also there. Okay. And these are the wafers or slices, either silicon or other semiconductor materials, and these are kept on a carrier, wafer carrier, and this is made of also quartz carrier. Here some grooves are there. Inside the grooves, silicon slices are kept like this, vertically parallel to each other. Now, both the ends are open here. At the input end, what we do, along with the nitrogen, dopant gases are introduced. Nitrogen will act as a carrier gas, and dopant gas, if the source are the gaseous source, the dopant gas for p-type dopant, maybe the diborin, for n-type dopant, maybe phosphine or maybe arsine. So along with that nitrogen, it will be introduced inside the tube, and then this region is a high temperature zone. In the high temperature zone, the impurity atom will diffuse into the silicon, and those rest of the gases will be ejected from the output, and it is connected to exhaust system so that it is taken out from the tube. So a constant flow inside the tube is maintained, and that flow should not be turbulent motion. Is a laminar flow motion is maintained inside the tube, constant flow, and diffusion will take place. This is the schematic structure of an open tube furnace diffusion. And here the temperature profile of this diffusion furnace is something like this. If we plot the temperature versus the distance, that means from this end, for example, to that end, so it will be like that. So here it is more than room temperature, maybe 70 or 80 degrees centigrade, then gradually it will increase. So that portion is a ramp up portion, it is known as ramp up, and then a constant temperature is maintained here over the length of the tube. The temperature is maintained constant at this value. What is that value? That is our set point, set or desired value that we can set in the furnace. That temperature may be 900, maybe 1000 degree centigrade, maybe 11 degree centigrade, whatever you feel like. So that will constant, and after, at the end also, this edge of the diffusion furnace, again it will gradually, the temperature will fall down, and this region is known as a ramp down region. So ramp up is this portion and ramp down is this portion, and this is known as the central region, is known as flat zone. In a this flat zone is for few centimeters, and that is mentioned here, flat zone. For 600 to 1200 degrees centigrade, this flat zone is 10 centimeter for laboratory furnaces, and that is 25 centimeter for industrial unit. The flat zone is small for laboratory grade furnace and large for industrial unit. Why? Because if flat zone is more, you can keep more number of wafers for in a single batch. In a particular batch, if flat zone is long, then you can keep lot of wafers, more wafers. So at one run, you can complete diffusion many wafers, that is the effective, cost effective. Okay. But if you want flat zone more, that means your furnace design will be critical. So automatically the cost of the furnace will be higher, isn't it? A temperature controller and heating element arrangements will be much more critical if you need this particular constant temperature zone over a longer region. Okay, and now in this particular case, that wafers are inserted into the tube. Manually you can insert also, or sometimes some mechanical pullers are used to insert the wafers into the tube. Now when you are inserting the wafer carrier inside the furnace tube, then you have to be extremely cautious, because the wafers, if you, this is the loading unloading zone, you can open the lid, that is cover of the furnace, then it is coming out this side, and then you can insert the wafers into the furnace tube, and there the speed at which you are inserting must be very slow. If it is not slow, then what will happen? These wafers will experience a temperature shock. That means here it is room temperature outside the furnace, and that temperature is nearly 20 degree to 22 degree centigrade, and inside the furnace it is about say 1000 degree centigrade. That means the 20 to 22 degree centigrade, 2000 degree centigrade, if within a small time, if you increase the temperature, then that these wafers will experience a thermal shock, and because of that you may have crack, micro crack, that you may not see in naked eye, but micro cracks may form because of the thermal shock, and that will introduce defects, and that will kill the devices, and it will spoil the chips, and your overall yield of ICs will be poor. In order to prevent that, you have to insert, that means ramp up or ramp down must be very slow, so that gradually the temperature will increase. To control that, nowadays most of the diffusion furnace, they include mechanical puller. And this mechanical puller, they actually push the wafer, and 10 centimeter per minute. 10 centimeter means this wafer carrier will be pushed, or it will be pulled at a rate of the 10 centimeter per minute in that speed, sometimes slower than that. Okay, so that is a better approach, and a ramp up, ramp down at the rate of 3 to 10 degree centigrade per minute will reduce the problem of the temperature shock, and reduce the problem of formation of micro crack on the silicon wafer. Now if you use the ramp down, then the problem is you are this ramp down temperature that time also, because here you see is a room temperature and then is 1000 degree centigrade, so during this period some diffusion will also take place, you cannot prevent it. Just near the flat zone temperature here, so near the flat zone is about, if it is a flat zone is 1000 degree, then this particular portion will be say 900 or 800, something like that. So here also some diffusion will take place, and you have to count that also. So how can you count that? That is like this: the ramp down, the T equal to T naught minus C into T. T is the ramp down time, small t, where T naught is the initial temperature, C is the ramp rate, and small t is the time. Okay, a ramp down is equivalent to an extra diffusion time of K T naught square by C E naught, where E naught is activation energy of diffusion, and C is known as a ramp rate. That means ramp up and ramp down, those two times are to be included in the diffusion calculation, and they are given by K T naught square by C E naught. Okay, and flat zone furnace I just now explained. Now some features of the diffusion system are these: surface concentration should be capable of being controlled over a wide range of values up to solid solubility limit. That means surface concentration should be controllable. If you cannot control, then you cannot expect the control amount of dopants. Next is diffusion process should be capable, diffusion process should not result in damage to the surface of the slice. That damage is the if micro cracks, if it forms, that is the damage. For that, you have to use ramp up, ramp down of the ramp up, ramp down time. You have to count in diffusion calculation. After diffusion, material residing on the surface of the slice should be capable of easy removal. This is a very important point. After diffusion, always a diffusion stain will form on the surface of the silicon, and that stain, that means residue materials, has to be removed before going for subsequent diffusion. That's why in pre-deposition and driving, in between, there is a step that is known as the boron. In boron pre-deposition and boron driving, in between, a LTO is used, LTO step, low temperature oxidation step, and that particular step converts the boron into the boron glass. What boron? The boron which resides on the surface and which forms a stain, and that will be converted into the oxide boron glass, and that in subsequent etching step, that glass is removed in hydrofluoric acid. So that is important. That's why material residing on the surface of the slice should be capable of easy removal. In phosphorus PaClT diffusion also, just after pre-deposition, the remain portion on the surface, some stain will be there, phosphorus glass will form, that has to be removed, because that will act as a constant source in the subsequent driving process, isn't it? In the next driving process, we assume there should not be any constant source of dopants. If we don't remove that surface stain, then that will act as a constant source, and then the Gaussian profile, you may not get it. For that, you have to remove those residual material before going for driving. So the system should give reproducible results, and the system should be capable of processing a number of slices at a time. That is batch processing. That's why for industrial environment, people want a furnace of longer flat zone, higher flat zone. So these are the features of diffusion system, diffusion furnace. Now, in all the furnaces, we have to think of controlling the contamination. How can you control those contaminations? I mentioned that diffusion tubes are all made of quartz, which can be cleaned very easily. And after certain interval of time, those quartz tubes are cleaned by HCl vapor. How? These HCl vapor remove impurities by converting to their halides, and which are volatile in nature. The furnace tubes, after frequent use, and after certain time, you have to clean by sending HCl vapor inside the tube. Fire bricks are major source of alkali ion contamination. Where coming the fire bricks? That is the heating element. Heating element has passed through some fire bricks in the furnace. So those fire bricks are a source of alkali ion contamination. And those alkali ions are dangerous in controlling, are very serious, because they change the conductivity of the layer, and those are undesired impurity, because there is no desired impurity at all. Heavy metallic impurities like iron, copper, reduce the magnetic area lifetime. So those elements, sometimes intentionally we introduce to reduce the magnetic area lifetime, but when not required, these are unwanted, and we have to take care that those heavy metallic impurities don't enter into the silicon lattice. And those heavy ions particularly come from diffusion furnace structure, furnace different components, and also from water also it comes sometimes, because you are using deionized water. Although you are telling it is deionized, so some of the heavy metallic ions may be there, maybe a small percentage. So they will create problem. And halogenic compound is used as dopant source for backside gathering, that is damaging of surface, so that it can be used as a sink for metallic impurities. That is one remedy. Sometimes the halogen compounds is used as a dopant source for backside gathering. That means all the defects and damages are confined at the backside of the silicon surface. Because front sides are using, back sides you are not using, that will be all accumulated at the backside. Okay? So let me stop today. Rest of the part I will continue in the next lecture.
We will now show you boron diffusion into the silicon wafer sample in a diffusion furnace. What you have just seen is a boron pre-depth furnace. This is an annealing furnace. And lastly, this is a phosphorus drive-in furnace. In the boron pre-depth furnace, we will insert the wafer at the central zone that has been maintained at a specified temperature. You can see that the silicon wafer is being loaded on a carrier. The white wafers that you see in the carrier are pieces of boron nitride cake which form solid diffusion sources of boron. We have placed the silicon wafer between two boron nitride cakes, which are also placed in the carrier. The wafer and the boron source is gradually inserted into the furnace. Notice that a quartz pull rod will be used to insert the carrier very slowly into the central zone of the furnace. This job would be done through an automatic loading system in an industrial environment.